Hi everyone, I'm attorney at law Sadini Rameshika. I will be doing this video for the benefit of the final year law students on the subject Civil Law 1. Now as you all know, Civil Law 1 is a compulsory subject and I've decided to talk to you on amendment of pleadings and secondly on interrogatories. Now why I have selected these two areas is mainly because these are areas which have been questioned right throughout in every single exam paper. And these are also the areas where you can easily score if you know your authorities right, if you know your legal provisions right, then it's very easy for you to score at the exam also. So before moving on to the subject content, I would like to share with you a small piece of advice that I always stick to when preparing for examinations. Never go for an exam with pre-prepared answers. Now, when I say pre-prepared answers, what I mean is some of the students have a bad habit of taking a past paper, writing down answers, memorizing them, and they expect the same question to appear in their exam paper. But this is a very wrong concept and this is a very wrong opinion. What happens when you sit at the exam and when you don't find your favorite questions at the exam, you are naturally let down. And it's very hard for you to answer the paper. So to avoid all the inconvenience, what's important is to know your lessons right, to know your theories right, and as I said before, to know your legal provisions properly so that you can twist your knowledge around to answer an exam question. Now, with that, I would like to move on to the first lesson, which is amendment of pleading. Now, when we say amendment of pleadings, as the topic itself suggests, it's a change, an alteration or an amendment you do to your pleadings, maybe as a plaintiff, maybe as a defendant. Now, before moving on to the real matter or the real subject content under this topic, it's important to analyze what sort of questions you've been asked at the exam. If you consider the questions which have been asked, which have been questioned before 2017, they are mostly theoretical questions where they test your knowledge on the legal provisions and how you provide your authorities. But after 2017, we see a different structure to amendment of pleadings. That is, you have been given a practical scenario where you are given some case facts, dates, and also you are retained as a lawyer for a particular party, maybe on behalf of the plaintiff or maybe on behalf of the defendant, and you are required at the exam to set out legal provisions on behalf of your client. Now, when you attempt a question like this, it's important that you understand, it's important that you identify the party that you are representing. For example, if you are supposed to represent the defendant and if you accidentally write on behalf of the plaintiff, then you are not going to gain much marks at the exam. Actually, you're not going to gain even half the marks. So, knowing your legal provisions right is not going to help you if you don't understand the question properly, if you don't keep in mind what you are supposed to answer. So, having said that, I would move on to the structure of an answer, how you are supposed to structure an answer at the exam. Like in every answer, there should be an introduction, there should be a body, and there should be a proper conclusion. Now, when I speak about the introduction, it's important to keep your introduction very brief. That is a maximum of 6 or 7 lines. In your introduction, you need to show the examiner your knowledge about amendment of pleadings. So, when you give your introduction at the exam or the introduction, firstly, you have to speak of the amendments that have been introduced to the principles of law pertaining to amendment of pleadings. So, primarily, the first amendment was done by Act No. 79 of 1988 and subsequently by Act No. 9 of 1991. So this amendment done in 1991 is the one which applies to us even now, and it's important that you introduce the very recent, that's the recent most amendment, which is Act No. 8 of 2017. If you can briefly state what that amendment specifically is, then that would be Section 93 of the Principal Enactment was amended by Act Number 8 of 2017, where the word trial in Section 93, Subsection 1 and Subsection 2 was replaced by the word pre-trial. So it's no more trial from now onwards, it's pre-trial. So having said that, it's also important to explain why we need amendment of pleadings, or to explain the purpose of having an amendment to pleadings. It's basically in the interest of justice, or to promote justice, that parties are allowed to amend their pleadings during the pendency of a case. Some people actually say that it defeats the purpose, but the whole purpose of studying this lesson and the whole purpose of using authority to support amendment of pleadings, which is to show that it is to promote justice. Now, after the amendment, which was introduced in 1991, courts have taken two approaches when it comes to amendment to pleadings. The first approach can be found under Section 93, Subsection 1. Now, what does this Subsection 1 say? It says, when an applicant, or if you are a plaintiff, or if you are a defendant, whoever you are, you being an applicant, make an application to court before the first date fixed for pre-trial to amend your pleadings. When you make such an application before the first date fixed for the pre-trial, then court will have all the power. Court will have full power to amend your pleadings. Amendments can be done in three main ways: additions, by way of alterations, or by way of omissions. Now, just because you apply to court for an amendment, and just because court has the full power or its discretion to amend the pleadings, it cannot do it the way it likes. There is a certain guideline which was set out by the case of, I will quote it, Mackinnon Mackenzie and Corporation versus Grindlay's Bank. I will repeat it. Mackinnon Mackenzie and Corporation versus Grindlay's Bank. Now, in this case, there was a guideline set out which had to be followed by courts when amending pleadings. Firstly, courts need to ensure that the only aim of doing such an amendment is to ensure the administration of justice. Secondly, such an amendment should avoid multiplicity of actions. And finally, the alteration you make to your pleadings should not change the fundamental action in a case. That means it should not change the character of your case or the nature of your case. If it is going to change the nature of your case, then courts will not allow you to make such an application. It is also important to remember that when you are making such an application, it has to be done in the presence of all the relevant parties, or with reasonable notice to the other parties, because otherwise you will be putting the other parties at a very unfair position. You will be doing prejudice. So with that, subsection 1 of Section 93 comes to an end, and it is very direct, very straightforward, a simple explanation. What matters the most here, where the real work comes here, is in Section 93, Subsection 2 of the Civil Procedure Code. Now, what does Subsection 2 say? Under Subsection 2, the second approach taken by courts is explained. Here it says, on or after the date fixed for pre-trials, if you make an application to amend your pleadings, then courts should not allow such an application unless there are two conditions to be fulfilled. Unless two conditions are fulfilled. The first condition is you have to show court, that is, you have to satisfy court, that grave and irremediable damage will be caused if such an amendment to the pleadings is not allowed. Secondly, you need to show court, or you need to satisfy court, that the applicant, or you making the application, you are not guilty of laches. Now, Some of you may think that it is enough to satisfy either of the conditions. No, you need to satisfy both the conditions. It's a mandatory provision. Now, the case which becomes very important when explaining this is the case of Gunasekara and another versus Abdul Latif. I will give the citation 1995 1 SLR 225. The judgment of Justice Rana Raja. Here, the learned judge held that when you do amendments to a pleading on or after the date fixed for pre-trial, such amendments should be allowed only under limited conditions. Not always, but under limited conditions. And here, the applicant should always satisfy the two main conditions. Now, what are the two main conditions? Firstly, that grave and irremediable damage will be caused if you don't, if court does not allow you to proceed with the amendment of pleadings. And secondly, that the applicant is not guilty of lashes. Now, Justice Rana Raja was also of the view in this judgment that not only those two conditions, there are three more conditions that court should be satisfied once those two hurdles have been overcome. What are they? Firstly, that no irremediable prejudice will be caused to the other party upon your application. Secondly, it will avoid the multiplicity of actions. And finally, that the amendment will only facilitate the administration of justice. Now, if all these conditions are satisfied, then court will allow you to do your amendment to pleadings very freely. Now, some of you may wonder, what is this word lashes? Some of you may know, some of you may not know. But for the benefit of everyone, I will tell you, lashes is basically negligence. It is you neglect something or you neglect to do something that you are bound to do by law, that you are obliged to do by law. And your negligence will ultimately cause prejudice to the other party. So that is what lashes is. For example, unreasonable delay in the proceedings of a case. So, before finishing off with section 93 subsection 2, it is also important to remember instances where courts will certainly not allow you to proceed with the application to amendment of pleadings. Those are the instances where your application sets up a new case. Secondly, where it converts the character or the nature of a case to a totally different one. Thirdly, where you add a new cause of action to your case by way of an amendment. In fourth, where you do prejudice to the rights of the other parties. And finally, where you are intending to change the substance or the essence of the original action. So if your application is going to fall within these five or in any of these five, then your application will not be allowed by court. Now, that is the scenario if you are the person making an application to court to amend your pleadings. Now, let's take for an example a situation where you are the lawyer retained on behalf of the defendant, but it is the applicant, the plaintiff, who is going to make the application for the amendment of pleadings. Remember, you are the lawyer on behalf of the defendant. So now, what do you need to do? You need to satisfy court that by allowing the plaintiff to do such an application, your client will be placed in an unfair position. So to do that, you need to satisfy court. You need to show court why court should dismiss such an application. Now, this is the other side of it. I will cite to you an important case where it will help you to bring up your legal submissions. That is Audiappan versus Indian Overseas Bank. The citation is 1995, 2 SLR page 131. Now here, this is another judgment by Justice Rana Raja. I will quote directly from the judgment. It was held that amendments contemplated by section 93 subsection 2 are those that are initiated due to unforeseen circumstances and not those that could have been foreseen with reasonable diligence. Now, if we put that in a simpler In simple terms, it means you can bring an amendment under section 93 subsection 2 only if these circumstances were unforeseen. That means, had you foreseen these circumstances, had you foreseen this amendment prior to making such an application, then you cannot proceed with your application. You should not be allowed to make such an application. Your application should be dismissed. So here you need to set out your legal submissions to court that such amendments which are being proposed by the opposing party are clearly foreseen. They were clearly foreseeable earlier, and such a failure was solely due to the lack of diligence of the applicant. So therefore, your opposing party should be deprived of his or her right to make such an application, and you need to show that allowing the application will only cause prejudice to your own client. Now, that is the main body of your answer, and this is where you need to bring in your legal provisions, your authorities, your analysis, all that. Now, before moving on to the conclusion, I would like to share with you one tip that I always follow when answering the body part of an answer. That is, firstly, I would identify what the issue at hand is. That is, you need to identify what the problem is, what the problem at hand is. Secondly, you need to set out the relevant legal principles or the legal rules. Next, you need to analyze the case facts along with the legal principles supported by your case law or the relevant authorities. Now, when I say authorities, the most strongest authorities will be your case laws. But apart from that, if you know your law journals or if you know some valid legal articles written by judges, go ahead at them. That will only gain you marks. So finally, we come into the conclusion, and your conclusion needs to be very strong. Now, when I say a strong conclusion, you don't need to do miracles to make a strong conclusion. You need only two components for a conclusion to be proper. Firstly, you need to very briefly set out or summarize your main legal arguments so that your examiner will have a quick recap on what you've said during your entire answer. So you need to very briefly set out your legal arguments very shortly. And then finally, you need to plead to court to hold in favor of your client. That is, if you are the person making the application to amend pleadings, you need to show cause, and then you need to plead to court and asked court to allow your application. Or if you are the opposing party, then you need to show cause to court, and then you need to plead to court saying why such an application should not be allowed and plead that such an application should be dismissed. So once you've said that, you are done with your answer. All you need to keep in mind here is, as I said before, you are representing either a plaintiff or a defendant. You need always keep in mind that you need to set out legal submissions which will favor your client, and finally plead to court to hold in your favor. So with that, we come to the end of amendment of pleadings. And without taking much of your time, I would like to go into the next topic I've selected for you, which is interrogatories. Now, when we say interrogatories, sometimes it may sound a bit unfamiliar to you. For some of you, it may be familiar. Now, interrogatories is also a main area, because if you consider the past question papers, every single exam question paper has this interrogatories lesson in it. Now, in this lesson, the procedure of service of interrogatories along with the consequences that you will have to face if you don't answer interrogatories have played a very important role, especially at examinations. But before going into the subject content, let me introduce to you what this entire concept of interrogatories is. Firstly, it's important to understand that interrogatories is not a concept which was originated in Sri Lanka in domestic law. It is a concept which we derive from English law. So, sections 94 to 100 of the Civil Procedure Code deal directly with the service of interrogatories, and section 109 will also play an important role at the end. Now, if someone asks you, what is an interrogatory, how would you answer it? Simply, it's a formal set of questions which are being set out by one litigant and served on another party, required to be answered by that particular party. Now, what would be the purpose of serving these interrogatories? Here, it's important to understand that in the case of Kennedy versus Dodson, I would repeat, Kennedy versus Dodson, the purpose of serving interrogatories was identified. I will quote directly from the judgment. The purpose of interrogatories is to obtain admissions from the opposition who flatly deny a position raised by the party interrogating his pleadings. Right. So if I'm going to put this into simple terms, let's say you are a plaintiff and I am the defendant. You are raising a certain position during the pendency of a case and I deny such a position. You have the right, you have the freedom of sending interrogatories to me to ask me why I deny such a position, and also to help you clarify the matters with regarding to the facts of the case. Now, to clarify such doubts is the main purpose of interrogatories. Moving on, it's important to note again that this is not a mandatory process in the legal proceedings in Sri Lanka. This is an optional stage, which is why majority of the practitioners do not make use of it, and these legal provisions which are there for the service of interrogatories have been rendered meaningless because they are not in practice now. However, for the purpose of the exam, it's important that you understand this, and I would directly go into the subject content of it, that is firstly the procedure of service of interrogations. Now, the main legal principles that you need to remember are firstly section 94, section 95 and section 97. Now, let's see what these legal provisions are all about. Section 94. Now, when you are intending to send interrogatories to a party, it's always important that these interrogatories or your formal set of questions are being sent before the hearing starts. And before you send it, it's important to file such interrogatories in court, and then only you can serve them. So this was this legal provision was given recognition in the case of Independent Newspapers Limited versus Gunasingham. I will repeat, Independent Newspapers Limited versus Gunasingham. Now there is a proviso to section 94. Proviso means an exception. Here it says, a party cannot deliver more than one set of interrogatories without prior permission from court. Now, let's say you have sent me, you are the plaintiff, I'm the defendant, you have sent me a set of interrogatories which I am required to answer. But you also have a different set of interrogatories which you need to deliver to me. In such circumstances, you need to first seek permission from court, and then only you can serve such interrogatories on me. So this legal provision has been given recognition in the case of Gunawardena versus Dunuville. I repeat, Gunawardena versus Dunuville. Now that is section 94 and its exception. Now next we have section 95. To whom are we going to serve interrogatories? A very valid question. Now interrogatories can be served or delivered either to the registered attorney who is appearing on behalf of a party, or to the party himself. If you are the plaintiff and if you are sending interrogatories, you can either give it to the registered attorney of your defendant or to the defendant himself. In what manner? In the manner, in the same manner that you use for delivering summons. Now, delivering of summons or service of summons is a totally different topic, which I will be dealing with in the second video, that is the part 2 of Civil Law 1. There I will explain to you the entire procedure of how summons will be served, and it is the identical process which will apply here under section 95 too. Now, moving on to section 97, what will happen if your defendant or your opposing party is a corporate body? So, where your opposing party is a corporate body, you need to deliver your interrogatories or serve your interrogatories to a member or an officer of that entity. For this also, you need to take prior permission of court, and once you've done the filing of your interrogatories, you can serve. Now, section 94, exception to section 94, section 95 and section 97 play an important role when you answer a question if you are being asked for the procedure of service of summons. Now, let's move on to section 98. Where the grounds for refusal are being set up. That means you can refuse to answer any of the interrogatories based on these grounds. Firstly, if the interrogatories or the questions are scandalous. Secondly, if they are irrelevant, if they are not relevant to your matter. In third, they are not bona fide for the purpose of action. Now, bona fide means not done in good faith. If the questions are not set in good faith, then you can still refuse to answer. Fourth, if answering such interrogatories will incriminate the party himself. And in fifth, if the interrogatories are not material enough at that particular stage of the action. So if you believe that you should refuse to answer any of the interrogatories, then reasonable reasons will only be set out under these five or under section 98, the grounds. Now, when should you answer interrogatories is also an important question. That is section 99. Interrogatories will have to be answered within 10 days. 10 days of service or within further time that the court will fix for you. That is, if the court will fix a date for you within that particular period of time, you need to answer your interrogatories. Now, how do you answer them? They have to be answered by way of an affidavit. That is also important to remember. You can't just set it out in a piece of paper. You need to do it by the way of an affidavit. The particular formalities should be followed. So with that, we come to the end of the first part, first important part of interrogatories. Now, I will address you secondly on the consequences that you will have to face if you don't answer interrogatories. Now, consequences are set out in section 100. Now, what is said in section 100 is, if you fail to answer interrogatories. Now, when you say fail, there are three main ways where you can fail to answer interrogatories. Firstly, you omit to answer. That is, you don't answer it simply. Secondly, you refuse to answer. That is, you don't answer deliberately. Finally, you answer insufficiently, that is, you answer in such a way that it does not answer the interrogatories properly. So that is insufficient answers. If your refusal to answer or your failure to answer comes within these three scopes, then you will fall under section 100. In such a circumstance, what a party interrogating can do is they can always apply to court, or they can make an application to court requesting for an order requiring you to answer the interrogatories. Then what court will do is they will consider the application, and they will, if they are satisfied that you should answer the interrogatories, they will issue an order. Now, when you answer your interrogatories as per this order, it can be also again once again in the format of an affidavit or a viva examination. Now, let's say you still fail to comply under section 100. What happens next? Section 109, as I mentioned earlier, becomes important here. Now, when you don't comply with the order issued under section 100, if you are the plaintiff, now let's say I am the defendant, you are the plaintiff, I am sending you a set of interrogatories where you refuse to answer. And the reasons for your refusal don't fall under section 98. That means you don't have a reasonable cause to refuse to answer. You are required to answer, but you fail to do so. Then you don't you also don't comply with Section 100. What happens is, you as the plaintiff failing to provide answers for interrogatories, your action will be dismissed. Now, when you say action will be dismissed, it entirely means that you cannot file action against me, being the same party, on the same cause of action again. Your entire action is dismissed. But if it's the defendant, that is, if it's me who is failing to answer, if I fail to answer your interrogatories and if I still fail to comply with Section 100, what will court do to me? They will, my answer to the plaint, my answer that I provided to the plaint priorly, will be struck off. Then I will be placed in such a situation that I have not appeared for the case and that I have not answered the plaint. That means it will take the face of an ex parte trial. Now, ex parte trials are a totally different area which I will be dealing with in the next video. But for the purpose of this particular section, Section 109, it's important to remember that if you are the defendant, if you fail to answer your interrogatories and if you still fail to comply with Section 100, then you will be placed in the position of an ex parte trial. And not stopping from there, court will hold you liable for contempt of court, which is a serious offence. Now here, one important case is Ceylon Insurance Corporation Limited versus Sudhabanda. I will quote it again. Ceylon Insurance Corporation Limited versus Sudhabanda. Here, what was decided in the case was that when a party is sending interrogatories, and if you fail to answer such interrogatories, and when that party is making an application under Section 100, then such an application should be made with reasonable notice to the opposing party, because a court will always consider submissions on behalf of the plaintiff and also your submissions on behalf of the defendant as to why you did not answer. If the court is satisfied that the reason why you didn't answer falls within Section 98, then court will not issue an order for you to answer the interrogatories. But if it's an unreasonable reason, or if it is if there is no reason for you to refuse your answer, then court will always issue an order under Section 100 to answer the interrogatory. With that, we come to the end of interrogatories. And once again, what I've got to say is, if you consider the past paper questions, interrogatories has been a completely theoretical nature, has been theoretical in nature. That is, you are being tested on the theory. So when it comes to theory, once again, it's your introduction, it's your body of the answer, and finally your conclusion. But within these, it's important that you set out your legal provisions, that is your sections, the legal principles, that is, at least you need to explain in your own words what these sections provide for in law. You need to support your legal provisions with relevant case law, and then you need to conclude and connect to the question all the time. Always remember, whatever the question you're being given, it's important to connect to the question by the time you conclude your answer. Otherwise, there will be a gap between the question and the answer, and the examiner will ultimately understand that you have come to an exam with pre-prepared answers, as I told you earlier. So to avoid all that, you need to always connect to the question. So I hope these two lessons, amendment of pleadings and interrogatories, was of some importance to you. I'm sure it will be an important part for the examination as well, because these are frequently questioned areas. So read sections 93 and also sections 94, 95, 97, section 98, 99, section 100, section 109, because these are all important legal provisions. If you know your legal provisions by heart, that's so much the better. But if you don't know, it's important that you explain in your own words, at least that is important. With that, we come to the end of today's video. For the next video, I will be doing failure in appearances, that is ex parte trials and service of summons. Until then, have a good day.